Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chat, episode 350, featuring a look at the game Stardew Valley. Now this is a game, I guess you could say it was inspired by Harvest Moon, and games like Animal Crossing. There's farming, mining, foraging, visiting with neighbors, there's combat, crafting. I mean, this game really seems to have it all. I've been having a whole lot of fun with it, and I wanted to share it with you. So without further ado, here is Stardew Valley.
Hi, and here we go, folks, with a little game called Stardew Valley. It came out back in February of 2016. I don't know when you'll be watching this. And it's a, I guess you would call it a sort of spiritual successor to games like Harvest Moon and to some extent Animal Crossing. Now I have to admit, I haven't played either one of those games, so I'm not the person to ask if you want to know about how it compares to those games. Those guys who do know those games, please chime in all you want to in the comments, and you can tell me what you notice. Of course, Animal Crossing is known for it's got a real-time aspect to it that some people love and some people don't like. And Harvest Moon, that's of course a lot older than this, and I don't think it has the crafting and gathering component. At least I read one review that said that. Again, not sure. Just passing on some stuff I read. But anyway, the consensus seems to be that if you like Harvest Moon, Animal Crossing, those kinds of games, you'll probably like this one, if not actually prefer it to those other games. So, with that said, let's just look at this game. The first step, of course, to create a character, and there's quite a few options here. That looks pretty nice. I wasn't able to find a hair option that was exactly like my hair. Not that that's all that important. this one's probably pretty close. You know, you got quite a few options, and you'll be spending a lot of time looking at the character. So I don't think it's a bad idea at all to, you know, take some time and really create something you like. I don't think that's gonna work. It's like most of the characters with long hair have bangs. I don't even want to think about what I would look like with bangs. Yeah, no. Just. Okay, I'm gonna quit this game now. Oh, anyway, let's just pick one here, for God's sake. No. Just trying to find something I can live with here. What about? Yeah, that looks okay. A lot of people ask me how long it took me to grow my hair, as long as it is, and I seem like it took a couple years really. I think it takes 7 years to really grow a full, you know, full mane, if you will. Now my hair, it grew taller before it grew long, so keep that in mind. I had quite the fro for several months, if not years, before it finally got long enough to fall over. I wish I could grow a big beard, you know, to go with the hair. Unfortunately, I just don't have the right genes for that, I guess. Alright, let's put those voice acting chops to work.
And for my very special grandson, I want you to have this sealed envelope. No, don't open it yet. Have patience. Now listen close. There will come a day when you feel crushed by the burden of modern life. And your bright spirit will fade before a growing emptiness. When that happens, my boy, you'll be ready for this gift. Now, let Grandpa rest.
I gotta say, the first time I saw that little sequence there, it actually brought a tear to my eye. It's just something about the music and the writing there. It just kind of hit me the right way, I guess. But it really got to me. Made a great impression. Now, as you can see here, though, we've got a anti-corporate agenda at work here. Or at least the anti-cube slave, whatever you want to call these sort of corporate types. I guess in the developer of this game, one Eric Barone, he's out of Seattle. I contacted him to see if I can get him on the show. I'm really curious if he himself you know, worked for some kind of big studio at some point before he went indie, and can directly relate to this cube slave aspect of these jobs, you know. Dear Matty McMatt, if you're reading this, you must be in dire need. So here's Grandpa's sealed envelope, which turns out to be a deed to Stardew Valley. And now we have about $1 million in back taxes we have to pay. Just kidding. I think that's probably the most unrealistic part of this whole game, is there's no taxes to pay on the land. no insurance required, nothing like that. No Monsanto to deal with. It's just back to nature. Stardew Valley, that wonderful refuge from reality. If you're anything like me, you're just really impressed by the quality of the sprite art we're seeing all over the place. A little bird animation. I mean, little touches like that. You guys have a little bit of game development background. You can appreciate the work it takes to do that. Put those little touches in. You know, it's not as easy as it might look. So here's Robin, the local carpenter. We have a red-headed carpenter in this game. And there's quite a bit of socializing that we'll need to do. Again, this is kind of open. You decide sort of what your goals are. You can go around talking to people and build these relationships. Even get married and have kids or adopt. You can have a gay marriage if you like. But that will require time and effort to go talk to them every day and give them gifts. I'll have more to say about that later. As you can see, though, my first priority is going to be dealing with this huge mess. I mean, I guess this farm has been abandoned now for 20 years. So there's going to be quite a bit of initial cleaning up we have to do. And this is our house. And it looks okay, I guess, but it will need to also be expanded quite a bit. And here's Lewis, the mayor, the new farmer. Again, good quality artwork on those character portraits. Look at that. Looks almost like a good 80s cartoon level quality. Kind of reminds me a little bit of the Littles, if you remember. I guess nobody remembers that cartoon, I'm sure. Except for you, don't you? You remember that one. Alright, so we're just getting sort of set up here. This is Grandfather's old cottage. It's very rustic. I love that. Yeah, it's very rustic, Lewis. Rustic, that's one way to put it. Crusty might be a little more apt. Yeah, so that's, he didn't like that. Rude! Yeah, we're gonna have to fix up the house. Actually, we don't have to do that. We just have to save up enough money to give to Robin the carpenter. And she will upgrade it. We can add a kitchen onto it. That's as far as I've gotten, actually. There's another expansion you can get that will put a nursery in there. I guess that's probably for raising kids. Not there yet in my gameplay, but that's certainly exciting. That will take a bunch of hardwood. That's a weird phrase. Yes, we'll need hardwood to have a nursery. Lots and lots of hardwood. I'll just leave it. I'll show you how to gather that later, but you can't do everything all at once. I'd say that's one of the things I like about this game as a sandbox style game. You've only got so many hours in a day, right? So you can't do everything you would like to do. So you have to make priorities and you have to figure out what you can realistically do. The good news, though, is that, you know, the years go by, spring will come again, fall will come again, whatever. So whatever you don't get done now, you'll have another chance to do it later. So there's no real reason to be in a big rush to do everything. One of the first quests is to talk to everybody. You know, and even if, I don't even think you could get that done if that's all you did all day, because the people are pretty spread out and it's kind of hard to find them sometimes, but there's no real reason to rush with it, I don't think. So every day you can check your television to get the weather and see what the fortune teller has to say about the luck. Not exactly sure what difference it makes. I guess you might find extra stuff if the gods are feeling well-disposed, or the spirits, whatever. And then there's a living one, living off the land, that'll give you tips. And then there's also one that'll teach you recipes and other shows. So in other words, you should check the television every day. Now, we've got various tools to work with here. We've got a hoe, we've got an axe, we've got a pickaxe, and we've got a scythe, and later on we'll get a fishing pole. And all these tools, as you could probably guess, are upgradable. Be a while before we can do that, but even starting off, they're not too bad. But if you look over to the bottom right of the screen, you'll see an energy bar. And pretty much everything I do is going to be using up energy, but especially chopping and uses up a lot of energy. And pickaxes use a lot of energy. But even look at this, even just watering the crop uses energy. Now the first few times I played this, actually for a long time I was just clicking individually on each little pod to water it. And I thought, man, this is so tedious, you know? Almost, I wanted to quit playing the game on account of it. And but then I went online to see, you know, if other people had been criticizing it for that reason, and sure enough there were. But somebody pointed out, you know, actually folks, if you just hold down the button and move the mouse around, you don't have to keep clicking. You can just hold it down and he'll water everything within that 6-block radius. So I was so happy about that, because that really speeds things up. Not necessarily something that's obvious though, so if you're watching this video, now you know you don't have to do nearly as much individual clicking as you might think. And then as you get these tools upgraded too, like the watering can eventually I haven't upgraded it all the way, but if you upgrade it twice, then it'll do a whole 6-block sequence with just one click, little 6-block area. I don't know what the ultimate one is. I guess it probably expands that even more. But that's important because you don't have enough energy to water, you know, this huge crop. So even though you might be able to buy a whole bunch of seeds and whatnot, you'll be out of energy before you get everything watered. Now, there's ways to rebuild your energy. You can eat food. That'll give you more energy. Problem is that you have to have the food, right? And then if you eat your crops, that's almost kind of self-defeating, I think, if you know you're eating the stuff instead of selling it. So there's a bit of a trade-off there, I suppose. But with the better watering cans, and later on we'll get sprinklers, and they will just do it for us. That'll be quite a while before we're at that point yet. But anyway, I like the decisions you have to make, and it's just fun to experiment. If I were you, I wouldn't even consider getting on some kind of guide and trying to figure out the quote-unquote, you know, ideal, most efficient way to do this stuff. I mean, come on, where's the fun in that? You know, I just like to experiment and find things out on my own. You know, if you want to make a huge crop and see how you can deal with that, you know, go for it. Why not? Well, worst case scenario, your crops die. You can always gather up some more resources and buy more seeds and try again. Now, you notice I made a chest a while ago. I highly recommend that. One of the two biggest annoyances in this game to me, and I really wish he would address them at some point. If I get to talk to him, I'll request it for sure. One is the biggest inconvenience is your item limit in your inventory. So I've only got that little, 12 spots up there. And you can expand that up to 36. It takes a lot of money, but eventually you can get a bigger backpack. But even with the full 36, it just seems like it's always full, and you're just always having to deal with not enough space in your inventory. So I didn't like that. Also, this problem. So there's these stores and vendors that you have to go to get things like animals or seeds or whatever. And about half, you have to be, they're only open certain hours. But even when they're open, it seems like a good 3/4 of the time, they're not actually behind the counter. And there's no way to buy the stuff. So that's really annoying. You can get online to wikis and things and find out what people's schedules are, but what a pain in the ass. You know, I don't know why these, you know, if you're going to have a store and have the hours posted there, why doesn't he just have the, you know, the employees there as well? I don't get that. And I know another nice feature, I mean, there might be mods for this. I haven't looked into the mods, but it would be nice if there was some kind of radar mini map or something that would tell you where the people are, at least after you've met them, so you don't have to go searching all around every time to find them. So I'm just trying to meet some people here. Now the way this works is each character, each villager, you have a little heart bar, see? And you get that filled up and all kinds of great stuff happens. You don't have to get it completely filled up before you start to get rewards. They'll teach you recipes, and I think they'll do some other things. I'm not sure what all they will do for you, but some of them are single. I don't know if you noticed that, but you can actually get married to those if you build your hearts up enough. So if you talk to somebody, I think that raises your heart level by 20 points, and then every day you ignore somebody, it goes down by 2 points. I think I read that somewhere. But really the best way to get that up is to give them gifts. And every person will have gifts they like better, like their gifts they really love, and stuff is just okay, and then there's some stuff they're neutral. I think there might actually be things that they will dislike you for giving them. I don't know, you can talk to people enough times, I guess they might eventually tell you what they like. But if that's something you're interested in, I think probably the best way is to go to the wikis and look for what people enjoy, because otherwise it'll be a lot of trial and error, very expensive trial and error in some cases. But it's free to talk to people. Now, I like this, the saloon is kind of nice, because if you come back here at night, there's usually three or four people gathered, and you can just hit them all in one fell swoop. Also, something else I love about this place. I love this little arcade game here. This is Journey of the Prairie King, and check this out. Some of you guys are probably old enough to remember a little game called Robotron. Now, there's a lot of similar games that came after it, but it's a fun style of game where you're moving around and you can shoot in each direction as well. So you can fire in a different direction than you're moving, which is, I guess, the key gameplay mechanic. And it's, you know, this is just kind of a little throwaway mini game, right? But he even went so far as to put in all kinds of power-ups. And you can gather up those coins and buy things from a vendor at certain points of this. There's boss fights. It really makes me want to bring out the X-Arcade. I got a dual X-Arcade that would be perfect for this, but I'm not sure if it's compatible or not. But anyway, it's definitely a challenge, and it gets the blood pumping. So if you get a little too relaxed playing the other aspects of the game, you can come try a little Prairie King. And I haven't got to this point yet with this, obviously, but I was reading on the wiki that if you beat the game, you actually get an arcade machine for your house, your cottage. And how cool is that? So anyway, let's move on back to the bar. And you can even make beer in this game. You can get some hops and a keg and make beer, and I think you can even make pale ale, which is pretty neat. I didn't get to that point, unfortunately, because you can only grow the hops. I guess I should say this, there's different crops for each season, right? There's four seasons, of course, spring, summer, fall, and winter, and each season has its own crops. And each season lasts for exactly 28 days. And at the end of that season, everything you've got planted, unless it says otherwise, will die at the next season. So it's very important when you're planting crops to look at the date. You know, if it's, say, the 25th, and you plant something that's going to take 10 days to grow, you're just wasting your time, right? Because it's going to die. And you should also be thinking, too, with the, we don't really have enough cash to do anything right now, but it would be a great idea early in the season to get all that stuff planted that's going to take forever to grow, right? And then you wouldn't have to worry about it. There's Abigail. Like to have a purple-haired wife. Pretty sure she's available. Not the nicest girl, though. I like, there's a school teacher in here named Penny, a little redheaded school teacher, and I don't know, she's she's my choice. This is the birthdays, and it also tells you the festival dates. There's several festivals, I think one per season at least. Let's see, that's Leah. She looks pretty good too, I guess. Can't remember if she's single or not. Yep, she's single. And as I said before, if you wanted to have a gay relationship, or if you pick a female character, a lesbian relationship, that's, you know, that's in the game too. You could do that. So we want to look for crops that won't take too long to grow, but since we don't have much cash, I'm actually leaning towards things that might be quick and quick and dirty, so to speak, so we could just get some money in our pocket.
These saplings are trees, and you can see they take a long time to grow. The good thing about those is they would just recur, so you wouldn't have to keep planting and replanting. And then once you got them going, just occasionally you'd be able to harvest the crop. I'm a big fan of the zero maintenance money makers, right? You plant the tree and all you have to do is keep it clear, keep the spaces clear around it, and that's all. You know, so that sure beats having to go out and water something every day. And I think there's some trees, all the basic trees like the maple trees, oak trees, whatever. Not oak. Let's see, it's maple. Yeah, it is. Yeah, maple, oak, and pine. So you can either plant those trees yourself or just the ones that are already growing on your farm. You can attach a little tap to those, and then occasionally you'll get a product from that. Oak resin or, and let's see, what is it? Maple syrup. You can turn around and sell that. So again, very low maintenance. So if you're really lazy like I am and you don't want to have the big crop that you have to tend to, there's other ways to make plenty of money without having to do all this work. Unfortunately, one thing I think is unfortunate anyway is that there's no irrigation mechanic. You know, I got a little pond there. It'd be nice if I could make a little path, you know, so the water would just flow through my garden and automatically water the sides. That'd be pretty nice, but I guess I don't want to make it too easy for you. You can build sprinklers. I don't know if I mentioned that yet, but later on we'll be able to build these sprinklers. Problem with those is you have to have copper or iron. You have to go into the mines to get it. And the basic model only gives you a plus configuration, so it waters everything and like a plus shape around it. So that wastes some space, and then of course you got the tile that's wasted for the sprinkler itself. Now the upgraded one will do 8 squares around it, which seems like a little bit better of a deal. But, you know, people are kind of divided about those as well. You know, it does take quite a few resources to build them, and I guess they feel like it wastes a tile. The way I'm looking at it is, we've got plenty of space on this farm. I mean, my God, if you had this thing completely full with you'd have to have the sprinklers to make it manageable, right? But you could have quite a big farm that was pretty much all automated, and harvesting's a snap, so I don't know, I'm sort of envisioning in my mind right now how awesome it would be to have this giant sprinkled farm that I just run around every day and just get money. Now you'll notice that I'm using my scythe a lot because it doesn't use much energy. And what I like about using the scythe is you can get this fiber, which is, you can sell that for a little bit of money, or you need it to make certain things, crafting. But what I really like about this, well, there's two things I like about it. One is that occasionally I'll get mixed seeds, so just little wild seeds, and you know that can be planted and make you money without having to buy the seeds. And it's usually pretty cool stuff. I guess there's probably things that you couldn't grow, you know, like the stuff that you see growing wild, like the radishes or whatever. Another cool thing is that once they get animals and get a silo, then I'll be able to make hay out of when I'm scything. So sort of mowing the grass, and I guess some of the grass you can convert to hay for free, which is pretty nice. So there's very little waste in the game. You know, pretty much anything you find, even the trash that you find, you can turn it into useful stuff. So that's pretty cool. So I'm back at the bar. See, as you can see, I told you before, there's usually a pretty good group of people here. You can just hit them all at once. The characters are all, they all have their own little stories. And, you know, if you get far enough along with your relationships, you can open up some new events, special events with them. If you're ever looking for something to do, stop by the saloon. She married. Uh-oh, yeah, she's not single, so I don't know, is that like a little adultery we can get into there? I don't know. A little jukebox. You gotta love the music, too. And interestingly, it was actually composed by the developer himself. This is, he sort of echoes his own philosophy that you see in the game, right? He's very self-sufficient. Just looking at a dev update he did back in 2014, and he says that he used a piece of software called Propellerhead Reason. And he actually steps you through how he composed it and how he tweaked his instruments. And he says, each season has multiple songs that play randomly. Seasonal songs don't loop over and over again whenever you're outside. Instead, ambient seasonal soundscapes fill the void between songs. He says it's important that each song enhances the atmosphere of the current scene. So, I mean, it's been a little lesson there for you guys. If you want to make a little indie game and you're thinking about music, it might be worth looking into making your own music, because I think this developer's right. You know, if you really want to just nail that perfect mood or whatever to complement your game, you're probably not going to be able to find some existing piece of music that just perfectly fits, right? But I can tell you, I've dabbled with music composition software too. It's not really that hard to make something listenable. You know, it's lots of ways to automate the stuff nowadays and help available. So it's not nearly as hard as it used to be to make decent music for games. And you could really get something that would just perfectly fit, you know, what you're going for. So anyway, I think it's really cool. Basically, my point is it's cool that he made his own music. yep, let's see how we did. So only 60 gold just for those daffodils. But, you know, that's better than nothing. Apparently, some people play this game way differently than I do. I was reading some discussion boards, and I was reading this one guy that he makes most of his money just selling the timber, right? So he chops down all the trees, I guess, and then stones maybe, and just sells that. And of course you can grow more trees just by planting those acorns and maple seeds and all that. So that might be a way to make money. You can also cut down some trees that aren't part of your farm. So it looks like you never would run out of, as long as you had the energy to keep chopping, I guess. And as you noticed, the more of each thing you do, the more efficient you get at it. Plus you get better tools, so you know, that might be a way, you know, I guess you could play this game and not ever even farm, you know? Just go chopping down stuff and gathering and foraging. And that would be a way to do it. I would never play that way, but I think it's nice that I had that option. You know, if I wanted to. Probably a good idea just to, you know, here and there clean up a little bit of this debris. Now we're going to get one of my favorite items, which is the fishing pole. And I like to fish in games. I'm a big fan of the fishing games. I played a lot of real fishing back in the Amiga. It seems like I don't remember the name of it. I had a fishing game for the Wii that I like to play. I can't even remember the name of it, but it was pretty fun because it used the controller in a, you know, pretty good way. I do some fishing even in World of Warcraft. I like to fish, believe it or not. But I gotta say, after fishing in this game, I mean, that World of Warcraft fishing seems woefully inadequate. And I'll show you what I'm talking about here in a second. So here's old Willy. Willie the fisherman. You know, this area's become unlocked now in the fishing store. And again, I think you could probably just play the game doing nothing but fishing. The reason I say that is because in addition to the fish, which you can sell and eat, of course, and cook with, also sometimes you get treasures from fishing. And the treasures are just all over the place. I think eventually you could get pretty much whatever else you would need. And there's some achievements that go with fishing. I need to talk about that community center. I remember not to forget about that. But anyway, let's just, as soon as he's done here, I'll show you what the fishing looks like. And just like every other skill in the game, you get better at it, it gets easier. And you can catch better fish, too. And the better rods you can get from Willy later on. I don't think you can make them. But they'll make it easier to fish, and you can also put lures on there and bait on it, so this becomes a lot less tedious. So here we go. So I got to keep that green bar behind the fish, and I don't know what it looks like, but it's pretty hard to do. You're holding down the left mouse button or tapping it rapidly, and you're trying to keep that bar behind the fish. And
sometimes the fish will seem to cooperate with you, right? They won't be bouncing all over the place. Sometimes, though, they're just going up and down, and it's really hard. Especially with this pole here, because that green box is very small on the basic pole. Like I said, you upgrade the fishing pole, then you get a bigger bar to work with, and you get some lures and things that make it a little bit easier. Now, if you can keep that bar behind the fish the whole time, never let it get out, then you do the perfect cast. You can also, when you hold the button down to cast, you can do a perfect cast and then a perfect, the perfect reeling it in, whatever that's called. And then I don't know for this for sure, but it seems like when you're able to do that perfectly, you have a lot higher chance of getting a silver star or a gold star fish. And those sell for more. So a little extra challenge. You don't have to be very good just to catch a fish. But if you want to put in a little bit more skill, a little bit more concentration, you can get rewarded for that. So I always love those kind of mechanics where you don't really have to be that great just to do it, right? But if you want to develop those skills, there's reasons to do so, and you'll be rewarded. So you see all those different skills there: farming, mining, foraging, fishing, and combat. Now, I haven't talked about the combat yet. That's probably where it comes closest to being an RPG, so we'll take a look at that, of course, before we're done. That's in the mines, mostly. So I want to go around, pick up these clams. You notice there's a bridge there. If you... Yeah, 300 pieces of wood. So if you gather up 300 pieces of wood, then you can make a bridge. And if you saw what was over there, there's some corals and little mussels and things you can collect every, I don't know about every day, but it's pretty good foraging opportunities. And that's what I love about foraging is, you know, it takes no energy. You just walk around, pick it up, and then you can sell it. I'm a little bit hesitant to sell the clams, just because I know from playing it before that you can use those to make some really awesome fertilizer. And, you know, you never seem to find enough of them when you need them later on, so... I'm always kind of torn between, should I just sell this, or do I want to put it in my treasure chest back at the farmhouse, right? But I guess you'll just have to decide that on your own. Alright, so I want to show you... Oh, he caught me. There's a guy that digs around in the trash, and he finds food. I'm not sure if the players... If you ever find anything as a player. But I've been kind of experimenting with that. You know, also, with the fishing, you can make traps. Little crawfish traps, I guess. And put those in the water. And then... zero maintenance. You just go around every day and pick up whatever's trapped in there. Put some more bait in it. That's great. You can catch some make some really good money with those. Alright, I'm just walking around talking to everybody. Let's see, still 10 people left. It's quite a diverse array of characters, too. My husband Kent is a soldier working overseas. I know he'll come back safe. So they got personality here. Sometimes they have the same message, but there's enough text there that doesn't feel real repetitive. She's not in a good mood. Yeah, don't think I'm gonna be marrying her. Let's see, Caroline, you must be Maddie McMatt. I'm Caroline. My husband runs a general store here. The pale one with the purple hair that's always in a bad mood. Doesn't sound like very good wife material to me. What's going on here? Looks like everybody's, you know, there's always... You know, I've played this game probably about 50 hours already, and it's just... You know, I feel like I've only seen about 10% of it. Like, what's going on here, you know? Why are they all... Must be something going on. My nephew Shane has been staying at my place. He helps me with the chickens. I don't know what's going to happen here, but I'll just get ahead so I won't spoil it for you, so you can find out on your own too. Yeah, I just watched a Suicide Squad last night, and of course there's that character Harley Quinn in there, and man, that is I know there's probably a lot of like 13 to 15 year old boys that are going to watch that movie, and they're going to probably have a thing for her, but man, could you imagine how high maintenance that level of craziness would be? Oh man, you can't help but think about it, right? You know, would it be, is any level of physical attractiveness worth that? You know, I guess in her case, real life danger. All right, there's the, I see this bean starter. Notice how it has that little stick on it. The cool thing about those is you don't have to keep replanting. Like these parsnips, once you pull them up from the ground, it's gone. You have to go buy some more. The cool thing about these beans, besides being really good for the heart, you know that little rhyme. When they're ready, you can just go harvest them, and then they'll regrow again after you harvest them, after enough time has passed. Now, the only downside is that the sticks, you can't walk through them. So I screwed up big time. My previous game, I planted a square of those things, and I couldn't get to the one in the middle. And furthermore, it just made it really hard to get around my farm, because I had created all these obstacles for myself. So my advice would be, with those, you really want to think about placement. Maybe only put those around the border of your farm. You know, so you don't have to worry about creating these obstacles. That's probably a pretty good idea, but the payout's pretty well. And you want to grow at least one of everything, I think. Because then there'll be some achievements to open up the community center that I still need to show you. But anyway, I've skipped forward a few days so I can show you what it's like to harvest these parsnips. Hopefully you won't screw up and try to fish in while you're harvesting. But again, you don't have to. I thought you had to just click on each thing at first, but you don't. You can just hold the button down and run around and pick up everything like you're some type of harvesting machine. So that's good to know. Then I can just sell all those, and then the next day I'll get paid and hopefully get enough money to get that upgraded book sack. Alright, so that's enough of this. I want to show you a little bit of my other game where I got some animals and other things, and then I think we'll call it a day. All right, so here's my little sailor guy. He's got a hat, boots, and everything. All kinds of cool stuff in his house. I'd love to have one of those skeletons. So you can see the kitchen here. You can cook. Some of these ingredients you have to buy from the store, by the way. I didn't know that. You can't make your own sugar and wheat flour. I don't know why exactly he did it that way. You know, it seems like you can grow wheat. Why couldn't you make flour somehow, or sugar? Maybe he'll add that eventually. But for now, you have to buy it from the store. I'm always torn between, you know, is it worth using the, you know, cooking and eating the food to have more energy, or should you just call it a day and or try to sell it? Apparently, there's some arguments about whether it should be more profitable to cook food and sell it, or just to sell your crops. And the developer has said that he didn't like that idea, that, you know, it shouldn't have to, you should just be able to sell your crops, not have to process everything. But I found there's certain things that do make sense. For example, turning your eggs into mayonnaise and your milk into cheese definitely makes it more profitable. It's not that much work. Now you notice with these chickens and ducks, if you click on them and get that little heart, the animals actually have their own little love meters as well as the people. And it's not just for, you know, shits and giggles. They will produce better eggs or different items, like I think the ducks give you feathers eventually, once they get that heart meter up high enough. You also have to keep them happy. So you see here in the winter, you have less crops to worry about. Some people don't do any crops. But you also have to deal with the cold, so I had to put a heater here in these barns. But you have to do what you can to keep these animals happy and well-fed, or they won't produce the milk and the other things you need. Like these little baby goats. Oh, it's so much easier to raise livestock in a video game. And I know some of you guys grew up on farms. I didn't grow up on one, but I've definitely been to them many times. And man, you're never prepared for that smell. Man alive, I just don't see how these guys ever get used to that. Especially the chicken farms. My God, I don't think I ate chicken for a whole day. I love me some fried chicken, but damn, that stench. Woo! Alright, let's get out of there. Also, check this baby out. Hey, there we go. That's what I'm talking about. Now this horse, you have to build a stable, and you have to have hardwood. Man, I don't know why. I shouldn't be chuckling at that. Anyway, you have to have some hardwood, I believe, and some other stuff. It's pretty expensive, but it's manageable. And once you get this horse, you know, in retrospect, guys, you know, my advice would be, first, you should prioritize the bigger backpack and the horse. You know, get those as soon as you can, because those will make your life a lot easier. Also, once you get this minecart repaired, that involves the community center, but you see it'll just instantly teleport me around. Alright, so here's the mine, and this is pretty far into the mine. It's definitely not this hard starting out, but you can see there's plenty of stone down here, so that's never going to be a problem. But also, you can find veins. So again, if you played World of Warcraft, you know you're looking for different kinds of... you got gold and iron and copper veins and something called iridium. But you have to find them, and that means fighting... they always seem to be guarded by monsters. Now, the cool thing about the way he's got these mines set up, they are randomly generated, which is cool. Procedurally generated, I guess I should say. But if every 5 levels, there's an elevator. So if you can get to, say, I'm on level 106 right now. If I get to 110, then I can activate the elevator on that floor. And then next time, I can just instantly go to that deeper level, right? So you don't have to start at level 1 and go all the way down every time. But on the other hand, if you find yourself, maybe you're all the way down here at this point, and you're like, you know, I need some more copper. Or I need some coal or something. If you remember what level that was on, or what range it's on, it's pretty easy to just zip back there and, you know, you can get it. Now, the ladders seem to appear randomly. Sometimes they're under rocks. Sometimes you kill a monster and the ladder appears underneath the monster. But there's a couple of really dangerous things about the mines. Besides the monsters, you have to keep an eye on that health bar, of course. But really, the problem I kept running into was I'd lose track of time, right? So once it... Uh-oh. So that when that happens, you're about to get attacked by a bunch of bats. And they can be a real pain in the ass. It's very hard to time it so you don't get hit by them. And every time they hit you, they take a pretty good chunk out of your health. But anyway, as I was saying, if it gets too late, or if you run out of energy, either your energy or your health... then you'll pass out, and when that happens, oh man, it's terrible. You lose like 5 to 10 levels of the mine that you've cleared already. You have to go clear it again, and you lose some items from your backpack, and it costs you money. It's just, you know, you really don't want to do that. So the fact that you can only save, you know, when you're in bed means you really have to be careful in these mines, and you can lose that health a lot faster than you think. So you want to bring some food with you, you know, and don't be afraid about eating it. You know, it's much better to just eat some food than risk dying and passing out in this mine, which can happen really quickly. So I'm going to see if I can make it to level 110. Now, just like everything else, all the other skills, you can get better at fighting. And if you reach a certain plateau, then you can get some talents. Nothing real sophisticated. I think you can get like a more critical hit chance, or just do more damage every time, every swipe. And there's different kinds of weapons too. I'm using the sword here. You can also get a dagger, and that's faster, but it doesn't swing like that. So you have to actually be pointing it right at the enemies.
which I found to be just too damn hard to do. So I prefer the sword. Might do less damage, but I like that sweeping mechanic. There's also a slingshot. But I don't know, I never could get the hang of that one. That might be one that's easier to, you know, operate with the gamepad. I just couldn't do it worth a damn. And on top of that, it seemed to lock up my computer when I tried. So the only time the game has crashed is when I've been trying to use that slingshot. So I don't know. Your mileage might vary, but for me, I just didn't have any luck with the slingshot. You can also find rings and some boots. Those will give you some advantages. It might be kind of nice. I don't know how much he wants to develop this part of the game. You know, there's definitely some room for more, you know, equipment slots and things of that sort. Maybe some talents. Maybe some kind of magical skill. That might actually be in the game. I just haven't got there yet. You can build little bombs. Cherry bombs or bigger bombs. And again, my problem with those is I kept accidentally blowing myself up. So I just stick with the old sword, and I don't mind. It doesn't bother me to just, you know, eat some food and replenish my energy every now and then. I don't know if it's possible just to... Oh, what's this strange bun? I guess some people probably have enough skill never to get hit. But not me. I have to, eat food occasionally. There's also some health potions you can get. But those are just... so expensive. It seems like it makes more sense just to eat the food. But anyway, what do I know? Alright. Oh, there's a little chest. Sometimes you can find the hardwood in the chest. I guess it's just random. Oh, look at that over there. Man, look at all that. There's gotta be some cool items. Yep, got some geodes. I didn't talk about the geodes yet. Ooh, magnet ring. Increase your radius for collecting items. Oh, that's pretty cool. Very handy. You want to hold on to the stuff, the old rings and weapons, because you can sell those at the adventure shop. Usually worth at least 100 gold. But the geodes, that's another side of the game I haven't really talked about, but you can take those to the blacksmith and you can cut them open. And there'll be artifacts in them sometimes, and you can take those to the library and have a little collection of artifacts in there, minerals and historical or archaeological type artifacts. And then if you get enough of those, then you'll start to get some bonus rewards. And it's just kind of a cool little collection. Little collectibles, put them on display. That's how I got most of the decorations for my house, was the rewards for contributing artifacts to the library. See, I'm already out of inventory space. Look at that. You know, and at this point, it's really hard to decide what you actually want to get rid of. My philosophy is, if you have to get rid of something, just eat some food. At least that way you do get the benefit of the food. But yeah, if you run out of health, energy, or it gets too late, you'll fall asleep, and then you'll really regret it. So let's see, I'm still looking for that exit. You have to get... like with the gold, the copper, the iron, you have to get 5 of them. And then you can take it back to your place and go to the refinery. Oh, what's this? Space boots! Ooh, iridium weave. So, again, I gotta get rid of something. Get rid of that, I guess. I really wish they would add on another... one bigger backpack or some way to deal with that. I think one of the problems is when you find silver or gold quality items, it takes up a separate slot. That's kind of a pain. I wish he would just put all that on one slot somehow. You know, it doesn't make sense that, you know, if you can carry 100 regular quartz, but one, you know, special quartz takes up its own slot, that doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. Alright, so you see, I'm a long ways from being, ready for those achievements, but let's go to the community center. Let me see. I'm debating whether I should, you know, let's take the mine cart. You see how much faster this is than trying to walk all the way there, right? Let's see. Bus stop. Nope, town. So there's the blacksmith in the library. Unfortunately, it's too late to do anything. I think they're closed. So you see, that's another reason you have to keep your eye on the clock. Really easy to lose track of time in the mines, but tomorrow I can take those geodes and artifacts to the blacksmith, and you never know what you're going to find in there. Sometimes you find the same artifact, but you can always sell it at a pretty good profit. So let's see, got some mayo. Put the large eggs in there, then you'll get high quality mayo. There's that maple syrup I was telling you about. So that's nice thing about the trees with the tappers on them is, again, no maintenance, don't have to water it, anything like that. I think those, the trees that you buy from the shop, I haven't experimented with those yet, but it says that you have to keep the area clear around it. And I'm not sure if that means you can just plant some, you know, paths or something, or if you have to actually keep it free of everything. But the wild trees, like the oaks and those maples, they don't seem to require anything special. You can just plant them wherever you want. I was actually wondering if you had the enough tappers, you know, you could make a pretty good penny with that. Of course, they don't produce very often, but you know, if you had enough trees, you know, it'd be something to think about. I'm also kind of curious, I just now thought about this, but I wonder if you could put a tapper on a tree that's not actually on your farm, because it lets you chop down trees that you find around. You know, I don't know if it lets you put taps on them. Alright, so here's the community room. Now, my understanding is you can choose to go this route, or you can team up with the corporates, the JoJo people. I wouldn't even consider doing that. But basically what we have to do, we have all these collections we have to build. So you see here's the animal bundle, and I have to put five things in there. I got a little bit of options because there's six different things. As long as I have five of them, I can complete it. And you get a nice reward when you fill up a whole basket, I guess. But if you do enough of them, like you can actually complete the rooms. You see I got some rooms complete. And then you get really nice rewards, like that minecart I was showing you. You can get bridges completed and access new areas. There's all sorts of reasons to do that. And I've yet to complete the whole community room, or the whole community center. You know, there's still a couple rooms. I can't do it right now because there's certain fish and crops that only grow during certain seasons. And, you know, there's no way to do it during the winter, at least that I know of. So you just have to be patient and wait with that. But, you know, it gives you, there's so many reasons, there's always something else to do in this game, right? There's all sorts of stuff just around the corner, you know, keep you playing just a little bit more. It's got that real, the whole one more turn thing. This is super addictive. Many times I was like tired, you know, I'm like yawning and sleepy, and I'm like, okay, you know, it's time to go to bed. As soon as this day is over and the game saves, then I'll call it a night, right? And then inevitably, though, you're like, oh, but look, I'm so close to being able to do this, you know, or, you know, now I have enough gold to get that, you know, bigger barn. It's always like so many things like that, and you just keep playing more and more. Next thing you know, it's like literally the next morning, you're the one that's passed out in your chair. I really, really enjoy this one. It's really just, there's so much to do. And the level of tedium is manageable. You know, it's actually kind of helpful too, because especially if you play it long enough, you know, you realize a lot of the stuff that's kind of tedious, you can upgrade it, and that gives you a really good reason to want to get those upgrades, right? But just the overall quality and the scope of this thing, you know, just the sheer abundance, it's like so much thought has gone into every detail. So look at that. This is the iridium fishing pole. So you can see how much bigger that bar is. You know, and like there's different kinds of fish in different areas, right? So this little special pond here will have fish you can't find elsewhere. So, man alive, this guy, he really deserves to be commended for this. I mean, I know how much work he had to do. You know, how much thinking and balancing and just
wow, it's just overwhelming to think about it from a developer perspective, you know, like just how much thought and attention to detail had to go into this. It's really just amazing. You know, really the only reason I didn't get into this right away was I took one look at the graphical style and I just kind of assumed it was one of those cutesy-wootsy, sort of childish, one of the more childish cutesy JRPG style games, you know, that real sort of manga, anime, what do they call it, kawasi, cuteness. I didn't want to be overwhelmed by cuteness, not really my thing, you know. I'm too much of a man to be caught playing a cutesy-wootsy little game like that. But once I got into it, I realized it's not nearly as cutesy-wootsy, you know, as I thought at first. You know, it's actually very deep, at least in terms of gameplay mechanics and the... I think it walks a nice line. I didn't feel, you know, sometimes playing those Japanese games, I'm just like, what? You know, it's almost painful to play them sometimes, right? This one, though, even though it looks a little bit like that, doesn't feel anything like it, at least to me. You know, this is, you know, if anything, I would say this would be something more like you'd see on the Amiga than on the Super Nintendo, you know, if that makes any sense to you. Anyway, other people really like that cutesy stuff, so I guess they would like the game for that reason. But I'm just saying, if you're like me and you're kind of looking at the game and you're thinking, I don't know, that looks a little bit too cutesy, my advice is just, you know, bear with it for a while. It's not nearly as cutesy as it might seem. And you'll be missing out on a really great game. So it's available on, let's see, GOG. I would recommend that you get it from, because you get DRM free. and it's $15 or $14.99 right now, and I'll post a link to that in the show notes so that you can go there and use my affiliate code, support the show, and get the game too. Let's see, it's available for Windows, obviously, Mac, Linux, and I thought I saw somewhere, it doesn't say here, but it's coming soon, apparently, to the consoles, Xbox One, PS4, and maybe even... Actually, I didn't check to see if it was coming out for the Wii U. I think it probably is. But anyway, I highly recommend it. I think you'll have a lot of fun with it, and it's very deep. And you could spend like 60 hours and still have lots and lots of content to explore. So, wow. Really great job on this. And that's it. Stardew Valley. Have fun, guys, and I hope your farms are prosperous. And that's all for this week's episode. Hope you guys enjoyed that. Hopefully be back next week. Not sure what's going to be happening. I've been trying to round up some new guests to be on the show. We'll see how that goes, but maybe there'll be another review. Who knows? But anyway, whatever it is, I'll try to make it worth watching and something you will like. And you know, as always, if there's things you would like to see, just let me know and I'll see what I can do. As always, I want to thank you very much for supporting this show, guys. It really means a lot to me. You have no idea. If you want to become a Matt Chat supporter, just go to that link in the show notes to that Patreon site. I think you'll really like that site. If you haven't looked at it before, it's not just Matt Chat. I mean, there's all kinds of really cool stuff that's being made and being funded by people like you. So go check it out. Also, you can buy Stardew Valley from GOG using the link in the show notes, $14.99. It won't cost you anything extra, but a small percentage of that will go to support the show as well. So, you know, that's really helpful, guys. Appreciate it. Or, you know, just telling somebody about the show is great as well. So, thank you for your help. Now, what about that news from the Matt Cave? Some pretty cool items here. The first is that the Internet Archive, I know I've mentioned them a few times, they now have added Amiga games. So this is, you go there, you play the games in the browser. Now this is on Indie Retro News blog. They were saying on there that they have 10,000 something titles, but due to copyright issues, only 1,351 are actually available. And some of those apparently just demos. So it's not the complete Amiga library, unfortunately, but it sounds like there's quite enough there to keep you busy for a while. And the nice thing about this is you don't have to figure out how to do browsers, you know, Amiga Forever or whatever.
even though that's actually very easy to set up. But if you just, I guess, want a quick and dirty Amiga experience, you can go there, check that out. Let's see, Stig wrote in about BioWare shutting down their forums. Now, I looked at this post, and BioWare is just saying that, you know, we don't really need forums anymore. We've got Twitter, we've got Facebook, all this other stuff. Why? It's just kind of a leeching of their resources, I guess, to keep up with these forums. Stig reads a little bit more into it. He thinks that this might be a sign that of another Origin episode. Basically, BioWare might be getting shuttered soon. You know, that's just what Stig has to say. I'd like to know what your opinion is. I don't really know what it means. It doesn't sound good, though, at any rate. And then finally, a little bit of a birthday wishes to the Metroid franchise. This really caught me by surprise, man. Did you know that Metroid has been out for 30 years? 30 years old, man. I mean, isn't that just mind-blowing? So apparently, the game, as you probably know, came out not on the Nintendo, but on the Famicom, which was the sort of Japanese Nintendo system. Came out August 6th, 1986, and then a year later came out for the on the Nintendo Entertainment System in North America and all that. I think this is cool. I'm not really a console gamer, but that's one that I definitely enjoyed back in the day. I remember going to a friend's house and playing it, and then later playing all the way through the first Metroid and Super Metroid. Those are my favorite ones. I'm curious about you, though. What are your favorite Metroid games? Let me know. All right, I think that'll do it for the news. What about that drink of the week? Well, this time I've got a sparkling cider. This is a Boylan Limited Release Sparkling Cider Cane Sugar. These guys are out of, New York, New York. So I like ciders. So this one does not have alcohol. This is just water, cane sugar, and natural flavors. So anyway, let's get it open and see what it's all about. All right, so I got some of this Boylan sparkling cider here in the rather excellent drinking horn. You definitely smell the apples in there. It smells a little bit like a kind of a slight vinegary apple cider vinegar. A smell to this. I'm not sure how old this is. I hope it's not past its due date. I don't see anything about it. I don't see a Best Buy date on here, but it's maybe that's just my nose playing tricks on me. It doesn't smell bad, though. You definitely smell the apples in there. So let's give it a taste. Definitely a sort of pungent, sweet, apple-y taste. not a big shocker there. And kind of a little bit of a citrusy component as well. It's definitely a little bit on the sweet side. You know, I could do with a little bit less sugar in this, I think, but it's not bad. Let me try it again. Yeah, this is to me tasting like a cream soda, one of those real sweet and sugary cream sodas with a little bit of an apple undertone to it. It doesn't have as pronounced of an apple taste as I would like from a cider. Let's try it one more time. Yeah, I gotta say, I'm not really feeling this one. The apple's kind of understated, which is not really what you want, I think, when you're looking for an apple cider. And it's a very, very sweet, almost like a cream soda level of sweetness there. So you probably get a sugar rush out of this, but not a whole lot of apple flavor. So I'm not real impressed. I guess I'll go maybe 2 out of 5 drinking horns on it. Not terrible, but there's lots of better, apple ciders out there that are much better than this one. So 2 out of 5. So I was looking up for quotes about farming, and I found one by Benjamin Franklin. And it's a little long, but I really like it, and I think you will too. So it goes something like this. There seem to be but 3 ways for a nation to acquire wealth. The first is by war, as the Romans did in plundering their conquered neighbors. This is robbery. The second, by commerce, which is generally cheating. The third, by agriculture, the only honest way, wherein man receives a real increase of the seed thrown into the ground and a kind of continual miracle wrought by the hand of God in his favor, as a reward for his innocent life and virtuous industry. See you guys next week.
You're still here? It's over. Go home.
Go.